Welcome back to the Miles Show. When it's Thursday at 2 p.m., you know it's the Miles Show. I'm your host, Miles Gisheru. Today, we're going to be talking about phobia. Remember last time we talked about OCD? So we're going to start with what is phobia. Phobia is the persistent and excessive fear of a situation, living creature, place, or object, okay? And in short, it's uncontrollable fear. For example, there's some people who are afraid of snakes. Okay, that's a phobia. There's some people who are afraid of height. That's a phobia. There's some people who are afraid of using the plane. That's an example of a phobia. Okay. How do common fears differ from phobias? The phobia is more intense and persistent fear. Yeah, like it's uncontrolled. It just happens. You know, like normal fears, like for example, fearing exams. You know, when you read for the exams, you will be able to do the exams. You don't have fear. A common fear is controlled, but phobia, whether or not just have it, it's so intense and it's more excessive. Okay, you know, when it comes to phobia, you really try and avoid that situation or that thing that you really have a phobia of. But you see, for example, like common fears like fear of exams, you cannot avoid exams. You have to do the exam whether you like it or not, unless you skive it and then you get an F, but you have to do an exam. Okay. Distress that interferes with function. Your fear of exams, you cannot expect that when you have fear of exams that you won't hit. You see, but when you have like a certain phobia, like for example, the fear of having of using an aeroplane. If you have that certain fear, like when you're up in the air in that plane, you'll really be very uncomfortable. And even maybe you can even cause so much drama in the plane because of that phobia. Some people even end up fainting, you see. So that's now the difference between a common fear and phobia itself. Phobias can develop around any object or situation. Some people may experience multiple phobias. They can be broadly categorized into two groups. We can call them their specific phobias. These are phobias about specific objects or situations such as spiders or flying objects. We have acrophobia, which is a fear of heights. We have aerophobia, which is the fear of flying, and philophobia, the fear of love. So maybe in Nairobi, so many people are experiencing philophobia. okay, that's it. Anyways, so now we'll also look at complex phobias. Now this is the other type of phobia. The first one, as I told you, it was specific phobias. Now we have complex phobias. Complex phobias tend to have a more disruptive or overwhelming impact on your life than specific phobias. They tend to develop when you are an adult. And two of the most common complex phobias are social phobia, a sense of intense fear in social situations, which is also known as social anxiety or social anxiety disorder. So some people who have social, social phobia comes when you're an adult, okay? Whereby you don't want to go in crowded places because of certain situations, okay? A lot of people find social situations difficult or feel shy or awkward at certain times. This is completely normal. Social phobia, however, can completely overwhelm you. You might find it very difficult to engage in everyday life activities, such as talking in groups, starting conversation, you know, public speaking, speaking on the phone, meeting new people, you know, talking to authorities such as policemen, talking to doctors. You know, you have a thing about, you know, social interactions, okay? Eating and drinking in front of others. You can imagine, like, if you go to a restaurant, you have gone by yourself, okay? And you have this social phobia. You know, and maybe if you look around, you see, you know, people like have sat in groups, and then maybe, and if you look at it in a situation whereby you are sitting in the middle, like, it's in that restaurant, now you're in the middle. You can imagine how it can be very uncomfortable for you, someone who has, you know, social phobia. And also going to work, you know. Yeah, sometimes going to work, if you have social phobia, it can really disrupt your day-to-day activities, or you can have so much panicking around it. We also see agoraphobia. It's feeling anxious about being in a place or situation, maybe walking outside alone, maybe in the morning hours, in the evening, being in open spaces, being in a crowd of people, traveling by car, be in enclosed spaces such as lift or in a shop. Agoraphobia can have a serious impact on the way you live your life. Many people with agoraphobia find it hard to leave the place they live. You see, even some of these people, even they are afraid of even trying to go for adventures, like, you know, maybe traveling, even don't go far like traveling, you know, outside the country, but also maybe traveling like, you know, maybe going to maybe somewhere like coast, like you feel safe around home where you stay. That's the only place you want to be, and that's the only place you trust. These other places you do not want to go to. Some of the things that causes phobia is traumas. Let's say maybe get mugged somewhere, you know, in the city. And that specific place, maybe they have a gun, maybe they have a knife, you know, they threaten to kill if you don't give them money, you don't give them your wallet. And then imagine, it sticks in your mind. And then as time goes, now when you pass, and then the worst thing is that maybe that's the same place that you use on a daily. You can imagine how you can get traumatized. Like you can start getting a specific phobia about that certain place. Like you do not want to use that route. Even it's better that you use a longer route instead of passing that route because of the trauma that you got from being robbed. Okay? That can be a cause of a phobia. Or even you can just have a phobia of the city itself. You see? Like maybe let's say for example if maybe you go to Nairobi City and then you get mugged. Now you'll have a phobia of going to town in Nairobi City because of you got mugged in that town, okay? Learned responses from early life, you know. Your phobia may develop from factors in your childhood environment. For example, you might have parents or guardians who are very worried or anxious. This may affect how you cope with anxiety in later life, okay? It's very important how you raise a child. It's very important how you raise a child because you might pass some of the phobias, you know, through the child, okay? So, in this point, learn responses from early. Like, if you are a parent and maybe you have a phobia of certain things in the house, okay? Maybe, like, you have a phobia of maybe leaving the door open, okay? So, you see, you can find yourself training a child to have such phobia because the child is going to learn through observation, okay? He or she will see what you are doing. So with time, the kid, when he or she grows up and understand things, you'll see him having a phobia of maybe like, you know, forgetting to lock the door. You see, such fears. Or maybe phobia of you being afraid of leaving the house. You find your child even does not want to play with other kids. He doesn't want to leave the house. She doesn't want to, you know, to interact with other children outside, the neighbors. You see, because of you, as a parent or you as a guardian, like you have that certain phobia of the outside world that you stay like, I can say like in your cocoon, like in your home because it's a safe place. You find a child, you know, having such characters. We see reaction and responses to panic. You might have a panic attack in response to a situation or object. You may find yourself feeling embarrassed by this, especially if people around you react strongly to your response. You could develop even more intense anxiety about the idea of things happening again. Maybe you're in high school, or maybe you do something foolish. And then how people react to to how you behave, and then maybe, even let me give a better example. Let's say you're a person who enjoys drinking, and then maybe one day you drink yourself silly, you start staggering in your neighborhood, and then now people react and start saying, oh my God, the way this person is. So how people, and then maybe you're a pastor's child, eh? So people like think highly of you that you can't do such things, and then once again you have recklessly become drunk, and then now people start reacting like they're like, oh my God, you see, such reaction can cause you to have a phobia. Now you'll have a phobia or even living in the house. You'll find yourself maybe when you're leaving the house, maybe by maybe if you have a car, you'll just be leaving the house with your car and coming back straight in. Or if you don't have a car, maybe start picking Ubers, or maybe start leaving when people are not in the streets. Experiencing long-term stress, because stress can cause the feeling of anxiety and depression. And you know, with anxiety, you'll have fear, and fear can cause phobia. Genetic factors. Research suggests that some people are more vulnerable to developing phobia than others. There are some people who there's nothing that can scare them. There are some people who can, they are risk takers. I call them that. You can find them, they are not afraid of, you know, like skydiving. You know, there are some people even who have phobias of heights, you see. But you find that those people they are not afraid of anything. They can take part in anything without having that, you know, fear. And then there are those who, a little bit of something can happen and boom, there comes in the phobia. So research says that, you know, it depends with someone's genetic, and how you are as an individual that can determine the phobia that you might get. We can also look at some of the symptoms of phobia that you yourself as an individual, or you can check for your friends or your child, you know, just to help someone. These are some of the signs to look out for when one has a phobia. Feeling unsteady, lightheaded, or dizzy, or you have that, you're feeling like you can faint. That's the first sign of having a phobia. Feeling like you are choking, that's also another one. And these are physical examples that I'm giving right now. Chest pains also, sweating. You see, you find yourself sweating because of panicking. Hot or cold flashes. Some memories just popping. You know, nausea or vomiting, trembling. Some of the psychological symptoms can be a fear of fainting, a fear of losing control, a fear of dying. Also feeling out of touch with reality. You detach from your body. Known as dissociation, okay? You find yourself like you are, okay, I'm feeling like, let me give an example. You see someone saying, oh, I think I'm gonna faint. That's a sign of having a phobia in something. Those people, fear of losing control, like maybe in a situation whereby like, you're like, oh my God, like I don't like this situation. I don't like being in this space. You see, I'm having this phobia. That's an example. A fear of dying. Okay, like if you find yourself constantly thinking that you are going to die, and now you start fearing like, oh my God, if I die, what will happen to my things? If I die, what? Those are also some of the psychological signs to look out for. These are not the only ones, but there are so many. I've just mentioned some few. Also, stress is also like an example of psychological symptoms of phobia. When you have stress here and there, you know, a loss of control of what you do, and also being overwhelmed or being embarrassed by someone. You see, that's a like that fear of, you know, even being embarrassed by someone. That's also it. So we'll also look at how to overcome phobia, and I'd like you to look at situations whereby desensitizing yourself. By this, it means that you can become less and less affected by the phobia over time with safe, controlled exposure. One way to do this involves exposure that is very small at first, then builds up. For example, if you're afraid of spiders, you know, you may start by looking at pictures of flowers that look like spiders, build up looking at pictures of actual spiders. From there, you may be able to watch videos of spiders and eventually be able to see spiders behind glass without fear of response. Like the example I'd given before about maybe let's say you have a fear, maybe let's say you get mugged in town and then you get a phobia of going to town. One way of controlling that, or maybe you know dealing with that phobia, is that you start going to that place pole, for example, because you know you can be robbed during the day. So maybe you can pass there by during the day. You look at things, maybe buy something, and then you leave. Or you can go with someone. You go with someone to that specific place. Maybe if you want to buy something and there's no any other place that you can buy it, you go with someone to that specific place so that they can be there for you in case you have an attack. And then as time goes by, you'll get used to that place, and then with time, the phobia will just disappear. And then you'll be like, oh, okay, I've dealt with it. So that's one of the ways to deal with it. Also, partnering up. You partner up with someone. Let's say, for example, you have a phobia of being robbed again in town and you're in town. You can partner up with someone whereby someone takes you so that you know, they can help you when you have that issue. Even another better way, partnering comes as a good remedy, is that if also your friend has a certain phobia, same as you, or has a different phobia, it doesn't have to be the same. You can also help each other by psyching up each other and watching out each other when you have that attack. Also join a supporting group. Like in the previous topic about OCD, whereby people go for group therapy. Also in phobia, when you are in a group whereby you join a support group whereby there are so many people with other phobias, not necessarily the same as you, but different, it will give you a sense of encouragement or a sense of purpose, or like you'll feel like you're not the only one. and you'll feel relieved that it's something normal to have a phobia actually. And this will increase your self-esteem to be able to deal with the phobia. And also when you have a support group, you guys can also be checking each other out, okay? Like you can be checking up on your friends, especially those people who have social, those social phobias. They really need that type of support whereby, you know, when their day, how they're doing their day, because everyone has to work, whatever they're doing in their day, you help them out. You are like, okay, how was your day? Hope your day was good. Were you able to manage your phobia today? You know, that talk can really help you. Also, we'll see relaxation and breathing techniques. Also, they are good ways to deal with phobia or how to overcome them. You know, when you're having those attacks, you know, you try the breathing technique, for example. The breathing technique is whereby you breathe in for so long and then you let out for so long. You know, you take deep, big, deep breath, and then you take out, a lot of breath out. You know, I'll try and have some relaxation type of remedy at home for yourself. That one will help you to, you know, to overcome the phobia itself. And lastly, when it comes to the relaxation technique, maybe combined with visualization, and like I said, also the breathing techniques, okay? You can also visualize something. Let's say, for example, for the fear of spiders, you see? Maybe if you see a spider and, you know, like it just came out, you know, you can try and relax. Don't panic, don't move. You try and breathe in, breathe out, and then with it, you'll just be able to overcome the phobia. So once again, okay, this is also another disorder that is there, and so many people have experienced it throughout their lives. Some of them might have experienced it and they have overcome it. Some of them, they still have not yet overcome it. And you, if you have not yet, like I've given you how to overcome it, those few suggestions or few techniques I've given you, it's very important. And it's very normal to have such things, such phobias, you know, especially like, okay, let me give another example. You see, especially right now, we were from COVID-19, where people had lost so much of their jobs. You see, you might have a phobia towards something and you want to overcome it. So fear of something is normal, so don't be alarmed. And in case of anything, you know, you can always have a support group. You have your friends you can talk to. You have these professionals, you know, like counselors who can help you through. So don't be afraid and get in touch if you need help. That's what we had today about phobias. I hope you've learned something. You can comment down below of if you have experienced any phobia and let us know and how you dealt with it as an individual. So thank you guys for joining us in this episode. See you next time and have a good day. Cheers.